दोबारा एक सेकंड।
निकुंज सर काइंडली प्लीज शेयर द स्क्रीन ऑफ स्पीकर।
यस मैम, डूइंग द सेम। वेट, यू कैन स्टार्ट मैम।
ओके, आई थिंक देयर इज सम टेक्निकल इश्यू फ्रॉम योर एंड सर, राइट? सो ओके अंकित सर, आवर स्पीकर सर एक्सट्रीमली सॉरी बिकॉज देयर आर सम टेक्निकल इश्यूज, सो extremely sorry that you have to wait.
No,
and extremely sorry to all the participants, a little bit technical issues will be there. So dear participants, that today's session were very interesting regarding the concrete field and regarding the water resource field, as this workshop on the basis of challenges and opportunities in the research field of civil engineering. So now we are having a very young, enthusiastic and dynamic talented professor, Mr. Ankit Soda, sorry my mistake, Dr. Ankit Soda sir, from Indus University, from civil department between us. So sir is a very legendary personality. Sir is like having a ocean of knowledge. Sir have completed his PhD from SVNIT Surat. Sir has completed his ME from Gujarat Technological University. Sir has completed his B in civil engineering from DTIT Nadiad. And if I will talk about the sir's achievement and career, as he is a doctorate personality in this field, so this will take too much time. So briefly, I will narrate that. Currently, he is an assistant professor of civil engineering department in Indus University. Sir is having a 2 year of experience in academic and 4 year of experience in research. Sir has published more than 12 research papers in various national, international journals and national, international conferences. Sir's main research area, research domain is structural dynamic, strategic analysis, artificial neural network, and so many field. So right now between us, Professor Ankit Soda from Indus University. So on behalf of all the participants, civil engineering department and S.N. Patel Institute, we are welcome you, sir, and we are eager to hear you. Now stage is all yours, sir. Thank you so much, please.
Thank you, Damayanti ma'am, for such a nice introduction. And I would also congratulate and thanks for inviting me, our coordinator, Dr. Damayanti ma'am, co-coordinator, Dr. Yasar, Professor Kayur, and Nikunj. Congratulations again. Okay, just let me share my screen first. Okay, so for the 2 days national workshop on challenges and opportunities for the research field of civil engineering. So for that, my today's topic is recent research advances in field of structural engineering. So let's start from what do you mean by structural engineering. So first of all, my presentation's flow will be generally I have focused for the, I know the some of the undergraduate students are also there. So I have designed my presentation in such a way that in starting, I will just show you the what are the remarkable structures and nowadays what just introductory type of what you mean by structure engineering. And then later on, I will focus on the research particularly. So let's start from the what do you mean by structure engineering. So it is the field of the engineering that deals with the structural integrity and the strength of the building or the structures. And this engineering is a specialty of the civil engineering that ensures the structures are safe and stable and it don't collapse under the applied loads. Okay. So here we can see some of the remarkable structures. Nowadays, recent trend is, as we know, the lands are very less in the majority of the cities. There are the land value is very high. So in a recent trend for the particular in our field, they are making the tall structures. Okay, multi-story buildings are there nowadays. So let's we start from the tall structures first of all. So we know, or we all know, the some of the remarkable structures are there, tall structures are there. So in generally, the one council of the tall building and urban habitats are there. It is called the CTBUH. So according to that, tall structures are divided into the several categories. Okay? So first of all, the height of the architectural top, then height of the occupied floor, and height of the tip. So here some of the tall structures we can see, like Burj Khalifa, Taipei, etc. are there. So how that CTBUH, it is the World Organization, is there. So how they are going to categorize, in on what basis? One is architecture, then occupancy, and the height of the tip. So let's see one by one. Height of the architectural top. That is generally the in that category, the height is measured from the level of the lowest to the architectural top of the building. It includes the spires and but not including the antennas, signals, etc. So this is just the architectural top they are considering. Then another category is, it is occupied floors. So generally it is from the level of the lowest significant open air and pedestrian, etc. at the height of the floors they are considering. Then the next one is, it is from the tip. So here in this level, it is from the lowest significant and open air, where like pedestrians are there, and height of the points are irrespective with the materials. Okay, it also considers signals, then antenna, etc. In that category, it also including. Now, as per that CTBUH, the tallness can be differed by the height relative context, proportions, and tall building technologies. So here HRC, it is the height relative to the context. So it is not just about the height, but also about the context which exists. For example, maybe if we take example of the Chicago city or Hong Kong city. So here a 14 story building is just a very normal building. So in that context, we can't consider 14 story building as a higher building or tall structure, because it is very common in that area. If we talk about our cities, so 14 story building, yeah, we can consider as a tall structure or multi-story building. So depend on that particular context, in which context we are taking. So as per that, that tall structures are going to divide. Then the next one is proportion. So again, the tall structure is not just about the height, but also about the proportion. There are the numerous buildings which are not particularly high, but it is the slender enough that gives the appearance as a tall structure. So in that category, we can consider it. Okay. Generally in the size of the length by width ratio, we can consider in that particular criteria. Then the next one is now the technology, which technology they are going to use. So technology which may be attributed as a being product of the toll, like specify vertical transportation technology structures with wind bracings, etc. So by that we can consider as a toll buildings. So depend on the which technology they are going to use. So that CTBUH, it defines super tall structures. There are in their categories generally, moreover, 300 meters in a height, they are considering as a superstore. It is about the previous. Nowadays, they are going to revise the data and they are taking all the area-wise, they are categorized its individual properties. But this is the general proportions. So although the great height are now being achieved by the building of the tall structure, in excess of the 800 meters at the midpoint of the 2011, that's Burj Khalifa. So it set one benchmark, like this one is our tallest structures. So based on that, nowadays they are going to use that as a benchmark, and they are going to categorize and numberize. They are going to give the index of that particular multi-story buildings. So now let's we just take about the one short look in our history. So several technologies are advanced and occurred at the late 19th century. Modern tall buildings are made of the possible due to three greatest technology in advance. One is invention of elevators. Obviously, without the elevators, tall structures can't be exist. Okay. So first of the invention of the elevator was done in the 1852. It is at the OTRs. Then invention of the new construction materials like steel and etc. Then so it was first introduced in the 1847. It was by the Kelly. Then reinforced concrete structures. The first introduction was at the 1849. It was the by the Joseph Monnier. Then the last one is our composite materials. Okay, we are going to use nowadays very. It is very common to use as a composite material. So it was invented in the 20th century, in the early stage of the 20th century. So let's take a short tour in the what we can say in our history. So we know the Egyptian pyramid. It was in the 2500 BC, and it was the at that time the tall. It was the 146 meter height was there in our that context. So and let's see if we talk about the recent buildings or in last what we can say in last century in our generation or some of the remarkable tall structures, let's see look about that. So the Washington Mountain, it is situated in Washington DC, and the total height of that, it was the 169 meter around, and the area was the 106 acres. Okay, so these are the several properties. I'm not discussing in a detail about that. So these are some of the remarkable buildings. So you can see it is the old picture. So at that time that tower was the tallest. So it just we discussed about that in respect to the context. So you can check in near about there is no such tall buildings are there. So at that time it was the tallest one. So here it was made up by the what we can say composite kind of materials they were used. Okay. Then the Leaning Pisa Tower, we know. So it is the that at that time height was the 55.86 meter. And nowadays they are going to lean. So obviously they have already used that performance based analysis they have done in recent, hardly before 2 years they have done the performance based analysis on that, and some of the retrofitting works are continuously going on because these are continuously going to lean in several each story by story. So that kind of studies they are going to do in that ancient structures also. Then our Eiffel Tower, it was duration was the construction in the Eiffel Tower was the 1887 to the 1889, and its height at that time it was the 300 meter. So it is situated at France, we know. So these are the some of the stage of the constructions. So with respect to each and every things, I will step by step. I am also going to just refer about that our recent research, as our title is the recent research is in the our structure engineering. So now whatever we are going to invent now, it is obviously we are taking some of the idea from the history only. Okay, so here also we can see nowadays one of the research topic, it was the stage construction stage analysis. So here also stage by stage we can see how they are going to construct the buildings or anything. Then the Empire State Building, it is situated at the New York City. Okay. Was at the height of the up to the tip height was the 443 meter, and it was constructed at the 1929. Then Empire State Buildings. Okay, so it's secure. It was the at the 1972. So these are the some of the remarkable structures that was present. It was at least before the 100 years or 80 years. So this is one time versus tallness ratio that that was covered in that graph. You can easily see at which time what was the highest structure ratio. So nowadays 1800 meter has already touched by the Burj Khalifa, but if you see in 1870, the tallest structure of the entire world, it was hardly at 130 meter. So as time increase, tall structure demand of the tall structure is going to increase. And in last one decade, you can see over here, in up to the 2010, it was hardly about the 620 meter was the highest height. It was for the broadcast meter towers. And up to the century, Empire State up to the 1970 or 1975, Empire State Building was the tallest structure. So as we know, the as we can see, the demand of the tall structures or multi-story structures are going to increase only, and it has haphazardly increasing. So now in recently, the one in Saudi Arabia, the Jeddah Kingdom Tower, they are going almost at the verge of the completion. At the 2022, it will going to complete, and its height will be 1,000 meter around. Now, right now, Burj Khalifa is having a height of the 828, and now it was the now next one at the 2022, the Jeddah Tower, it will be up to the 1,000 meter. So in short, the nowadays the research trend is also going to follow. Obviously, whatever the trend of the demand that customers are going to demand, that nowadays we know we need to go or we need to apply in the tall structures. So based on that only, research is also going to make a trend on that side. So tall structures. So in tall structures, in our side, I will show you in next slides. So by our side, the main research criteria for the tall structures that we need to find which kind of loads are going to occur and which are the different difficulties that we are going to face when we go in up to the upper height. So based on that, we are going to construct the buildings. So yeah, we can see the region wise. These are the categories for the region wise the tallest structures. For example, for the Asia, the tallest structure is the Burj Khalifa. It is up to the 828 meter. Similarly, for the North America, the maximum height of the building, it is 541. For the European countries, it is 462. Okay. It was the latex center. Then the, at the Oceania, it is the hardly 300. So at the Africa, you can see it is hardly at the 232. So in our region, tall structures are going into the demand in Asia particularly. So this is the our Burj Khalifa. We know all about the Burj Khalifa. It is completed at the 2010. And at that time, obviously, its height was the 862 meter. And it is the material they have used. It is the steel and concrete. And all the glass are at the surface areas. So these are some of the properties for the Burj Khalifa. It is given over here. So here you can see the exactly they are not going to use the material as a concrete only or as a steel only. So it is the composite in the each and every floor also. And at the upper stories, at the upper, I think up to the 7th or upper 10th stories, they have used for maximum, most of the percentage, if we talk about, they have used steel only for the, as a structure material. And in between, there was the concrete. And here also, in our previous slides, we will see what are the load wheels going to come. Here, RC ball panels they have used for the lower stories of the structures, obviously for the gravitational load, where the governing at that area. So yeah, there are the pile foundations are also they have used. So in structure, in my particular presentation for today's presentation, I'm not going into the detail of that foundation, because I think in next tomorrow's one of the professor is going to present about that, and in concrete also that you already studied by the moderator in the morning session. So let's not go into the detail of that foundation as well as in concrete side. So right now my presentation is only focused on the what are the different loads and nowadays new technology for the structure engineering. This is the Makkah's Royal Clock Tower is there. It was completed at the 2012, and yeah, you can see the nearest look of that. And its height was 601 meter. And now, Taipei 101. For as a researchers, particularly in structure, seismic dynamic researchers are having the more interest in the Taipei 101, because they have used one of the latest technology of the our seismic control system. It is the tune mass damper. So it was the first example or first experiment we can see for the such a larger multi-story building in which they have used that kind of seismic control system. So it was the completed at the 2004. And the height of the Taipei Tower, it was the 500 meter. Then next one is the Shanghai World Finance Center. So it was completed in 2008. And height was the that tower, it was 492. Then International Commerce Center. Okay. It was at the Hong Kong and completed at the 2010. So now, as we see, there are the number of remarkable buildings that nowadays they are going to construct in last decade if we see. So these are the growth depend on the availability of material, because nowadays we have lots of materials are there, composite materials also are there. In the research field, we are going to invite nowadays new materials, composites materials are there, which are what we can say, less weight with higher strength also there. So it is depend on the availability of material. Like for example, in pyramid at that time, that kind of such a material was not available. So at that time they have used the stone, but nowadays it is not possible to get such a massive structures. And obviously we are having the economy is the major criteria nowadays. Okay, the growth is depend on the availability of material, then level of the construction technology, then development of the services, and advances in the structure analysis. So these are the different factors that affect the growth of the depends on the tall structures. Now again, speed of the erections, it is having what are the different criteria that are considering for the erections. So nowadays, all the people are want to live in cities only. Okay? So we have to plan and organize our cities in such a way that we can fulfill the requirements of each and every people. So for that also, we need to improve our technologies. And in research field also, we have to invent some of the new technologies and material as well as some of the control systems, for example. So here, some of the construction stage analysis are given. So at the stage of the constructions, here, one is slip formwork, then second one is climbing crane, then pump concrete. So here, slip kind of formworks are given. So in figure we can see as the conceptions are going into the upper side, so my formwork is also weakened. It is adjustable. So simultaneously we can lift their whole formwork. Okay. So this kind of new advanced technologies we need. Now let's jump into the research side. So first of all, for any kind of structures, first we need to know what kind of loads are going to impact in the buildings. So for any analysis, first criteria is what are the different loads. If you talk about the multi-story buildings, so at that time we have to consider first of all wind load. Okay. Wind load will be the governing factor at the multi-story buildings. Then the next one is another governing factor is earthquake load. It is general about the multi-story as well as normal structures also. Earthquake load will be the most governing criteria that we have to consider. After the Bhuj earthquake, it is compulsory nowadays to consider our seismic load. Then obviously dead load, live loads are there. If my buildings or if my structures are situated at the area where snow is going to fall, so at that time we have to consider snow loads are also. Then blast loadings, so sudden blast are there or sudden kind of that kind of impact loads are there that we need to consider in our analysis criterias. Okay, so depend on the height proportions, we need to consider that how much of the percentage of that each and every load we have to take into the our criteria. Now the major constructions are affect the structure's functionality. It depends on the which function for which function we are going to use our structure. So for example, in modern offices nowadays we need the large open areas subdivided by the lightweight partitions. So for that large areas we need to have such kind of technologies to, without any intermediate columns, we have to make such a way that my slab will stand in the large portion or in a large area. Okay, and then main vertical members we have to arrange in such a way that, and again for the multi-story buildings the major criteria is the elevators, because the as we going to increase our height, so elevators are compulsory. So for that also our load will, we have to take that load into our account. Then staircase, service shafts will be there. Then in residential buildings, our permanent subdivisions of the respective foam floors are there. So at that time, we don't need to consider that criteria of the large floors and all. So based on the insert, based on the which functions we are going to use that buildings. So for that, we have to consider the our criteria for the analysis purpose. Then the fire protection of the building. So it is also one of the governing criteria that fire protection loads are, for the that also some of the instruments we need to consider. So when the flaming accidents are there, sudden accidents will occur. So for that also we need to be prepared. So this kind of different instruments also will be there. So for that also we have to make some separate arrangement. Okay. Now the old perspective for the base design would be design based on the fire rating of the material. Then what will be the my fire. For that some of the code specification of the code was given. It was for the old. So nowadays not only in fire but in each and every criteria of the analysis we are going to use the performance based design. Okay, so in performance based analysis is nowadays what we can say in a, it is in the boom of the research field. So in performance we will see in our next person, but now right now just we have to evaluate the strength and stiffness for that. And on which first we are going to analyze and we are going to make it to how it will perform, and based on that we are going to select what will be the methodology of the constructions, what will be the materials that we are going to use. So that depends on different performance, how it is going to perform. Then different factors which are affecting the structural design. For the higher multi-story buildings, vertical and lateral loads, as we discussed, the basic principle of the design is for the vertical and lateral loads, which are the same for the low up to the medium, and higher will be at the maximum high-rise buildings. But the buildings, we have to consider both the criterias. We have to control the vertical load as well as lateral load by making or by using such materials, lightweight materials. Okay, so for the higher vertical loads, we need to require larger columns, poles, shaft, etc. So maybe if load will be higher at the higher top, so at that time what will happen, overturning chances will be there. And obviously when we are going to make such a kind of heavy structures, so there are so many other factors also we have to consider. The higher area, at that time we have to put such a ground conditions also, otherwise it there will be a settlement will be there. So now earthquake, so at the during earthquake, moment shear and deflections are very high at the buildings. Okay, so special structures should be there, we have to arrange in such a way that therefore it made the structural material to make such a kind of elastic kind of materials, so it will be a flexible and we can resist the earthquake. So our special structures are there. For the special structures, we can use as a rigid frame for the multi-story or higher number of stories as we increase. For the lower kind of structures, lower story structures, rigid frames are okay. But as we increase the height of the structures, so at that time we can use that frame stress, shear stress, such trusses are there, then tube structures will be there. Okay. So it depends, as we going increase the height, there are several technologies are available. So now as we discussed earlier, that we have to, as an engineer, we have to think about economy as well as safety. So instead of making the heavier structure, we have to at least try to minimize our vertical loads of the buildings or light structures we are going to use, and simultaneously that material should be such a way that it should strong enough so that we can use it. Okay, so the weight of the structure, obviously the foundation cost will increase. So these are the there are several technologies that we can use, so we can minimize vertical loads as well as we can give the enough strength, or we can resist our buildings with respect to especially earthquake or any wind loads or any such a kind of loads. So okay, the materials are the reinforced concrete, cement concrete. Nowadays high performance concretes are also they are using. As I told you, I'm not going into the detail of that material part of concrete part, as sir has already explained. So, but even though for the multi-story buildings, pre-stressed concretes are also using, we are using, then some kind of new invent materials like composite structures, steel, high strength steels are there. So now, research field, if we talk about the research, so as a researcher or as a structural engineer, we have to think about that economy as well as our strength of the building. So we have to invent such a technologies that can bear the earthquake loads or wind loads, and simultaneously it can protect our buildings without affecting their any instruments or any above structures. Okay, so for that, let's we discuss one by one. So one is, as we discussed in the type I 101, the tuned mass damper. So the tuned mass damper is also known as a harmonic absorber or the seismic damper. So it is a device which is mounted in the structure to reduce the mechanical vibration. Okay, and it consists the mass of the mounted on the one or more damped springs. So here in figure also we can see in the Taipei building at the top story, they have put such a tune mass damper. One heavy mass damper is there. So what will happen when earthquake will occur at the ground story? So obviously my whole building as a, it will act as a cantilever beam or in a cantilever structure. So maximum accelerations will be at the top. So it will, it is not suitable for residential or any office buildings. So to minimize that absorbs accelerations, they have just simply put the heavy mass at the top. It is called the tuned mass damper technology. So what will happen at that time, it will absorb the all the harmonic waves. So it is specially for the skyscrapers. Okay, so it is suspended at the mast near to the top, and steel cables which are supported with that mast, and viscous fluid dampers are also nowadays used for the to support that mast particularly. And when seismic activities goes in the building to sway, the pendulum move in the opposite directions, and it dissipate the energy. Each pendulum is tuned precisely. So for that tuned mass damper, for that first we have to analyze. As a researcher, if I want to, this is our new technology, if I want to invent that or if I want to apply in any building, so for that several criteria that we are going to discuss in our later slides. So here one is tuned mass damper. If we talk about the upcoming sessions from the 2019 to the 2029, so now next 10 years, upcoming 10 years, you can see the how demand for the tuned mass damper is there. So market is for the tuned mass damper is going to boom. Okay, so here area wise also they have categorized in that figure, you can see. For almost in each of the continent, tuned mass dampers are nowadays in the demand. Okay, and in budget wise also you can see the in US also, if we talk about everywhere in China and wherever the advanced construction technologies are going to add. So at that time in skyscrapers, tuned mass dampers are it is the more vulnerable kind of technology, not only in skyscrapers but in bridge also. In tuned mass dampers, it can resist two kind of load. One is earthquake load and second one is wind load also. Here one bridge is there. So in bridge also we can see the where it is heavy mass are going to attach, or in mass also they are suspended with the springs. So they have make such a arrangement, like in this figure you can see that springs in vertical as well as horizontal in both the side, that spring arrangements are there and it is suspended with the heavy mass. So my if my structure is going to move with respect to the earthquake load or any kind of load, so with the help of that pendulum phenomena, it will come into the original position and it will try to reduce their accelerations. Okay. Then the another one is safe memory alloys. It is the this is also one of the very advanced technology of the safe memory alloys. In safe memory alloys, it is nothing but the alloys that can deform when the cold or any return in the buildings in any kind of materials. We are going to add the safe memory alloy materials additional to that. So it is also called the smart material. So it will, what it will happen at the time of load, it will going to deform and again it will come into the original position. Obviously our steel or any kind of other materials are also going to do the same thing, but the capacity of loading and unloading for that safe memory alloy, it is very high. Okay, so here hysteretic loop is given, load and stress versus strain hysteretic loop is there. If we apply the load in that material, it will going into the deform shape up to the maximum load, and again it will come into the its original position. So that kind of materials also we are going to add as a smart material or smart alloy. although it is very costly, but based on the what are any loads, if we are going to protect by this load, so at that time our higher story or any kind of structures, the other materials we are going to use, that we can make some kind of cost reduction in that other materials. So simultaneously, this kind of that tune mass damper also and safe memory also, ultimately it will be the economical. Here in the bridge pier, you can see the additional safe memory alloy materials as a, they are going to use in the as a spiral of that piers. So at that time, what will happen when earthquake will occur? So it will protect my structure. It is going to active when particular earthquake will come, and again it will try to make it in the original position of the structure. Here also in between pier and bridge, they can also use. With respect to the additional base air solution, that I will explain in next slides. But with additional to other seismic protection systems, we can also use these safe memory alloys. And generally, in a research stage, so what we are going to do, we are going to convert it into the mathematical models. So in safe memory alloys also, as other mathematical models, what we are going to do, the same things we can apply. Here spring, we can represent its gaining properties with respect to that spring, which is having some amount of stiffness that we have to find, and based on that we can apply. Then one damping property is there, so up to the which limit it is allowed to deform that particular bridge or that particular element. So that also we can control by the materials. So here the experimental setup is given. So if in not only in safe memory alloy, but if we talk about the retrofitting, we know it is generally we are going to protect our older structures by giving such kind of additional wire systems or any kind of systems with the help of retrofitting technologies. Or in safe memory alloys also, same kind of experimental setups are there, which is available as you can see in the your figure. Here one specimen is given here. We can apply horizontal as well as vertical loads. It is one load frame is given here. So with the help of this kind of such arrangement, we can first we can convert the mathematical model in a small scale, and we can use as a experimental. We can use that experimental properties for our research purpose. So some of the laboratories in which some of the we can see the LVDTs are there, by which we can measure the some amount of the which amount of strain it is going to apply. In this figure, we can see 2 point loads are given. They have make such arrangement that our I beam is there, and I am going to apply the load with respect to 2 points. So similarly, any kind of arrangement of for what particular purpose my elements I am going to use. So based on that, we can use our arrangement. Okay. Here one pier is there, or axial or element we can consider as a column also, or pier also. So here what will happen? Axial as well as lateral loads with help of actuators, we can give the load, or how much amount of strain will be there, at what particular stage my crack will occur. So for that, at that side, you can see the one cameras are there. So we can just use the as a micro level of the structure, micro level of the finite element method studies, it is called. So with help of very high resolution cameras, we can see at which particular time how much amount of cracks will occur, at which what amount of load, lateral as well as horizontal. So these are some of the experimental setups. Again, these are the large-scale model for the bridge pier. So these kind of facilities are available in some of this is from the UBC. In this is situated in the Canada, British Columbia University. So this kind of large bridge pier is available over there. In large scale facilities are there. Okay. Then in your one of the European lab, this is the facility in which building with the RC infill based it is tested at the European lab laboratory. So you can see the it is the large scale original scale of the building. Again, the substructure pseudodynamic test is in the same laboratory. It is also in the European laboratory is there. Okay, so in the pseudodynamic test, we can provide the artificial kind of waves or earthquakes with the help of the dynamic test. We can measure my structure will either survive in which amount of earthquake. So it is the two story steel frame, shear wall frame is given. Now let's jump into the another technology. It is the shock absorber. So in any kind of shock absorber or any earthquake protection system, one of the protection system is that damper. Okay, so in a damper, it is one technology. It is viscous fluid is over there. In real structure, you can see in any structures, the inclined kind of any element we are going to provide. And here, different kind of dampers also we can provide. It is one of the damper. It is viscous damper. Okay. So let me show you one of the video. So we can get the better idea for that particular damper. Just a minute, please allow me. Okay, so here I hope you can visible. It is visible. So here one of structure is having no. It is a normal structure without any. Technology of the Azure mesh. So and here one viscous fluid elements which are inclined in the lens it is given, and in the side table we can perform by applying the number of cycles of the earthquake, so we can measure. So let me start the video first. Here you can see the one of the structure. If we apply the load as a earthquake load at that time, with and without, you can see the difference. At the top, maximum acceleration is there at the without the dampers. And with the dampers, hardly some of the amount of the acceleration is there. So this is the a benefit of the damper kind of structures, a damper kind of technologies. So it can absorb our earthquakes. Okay, so it is about the shock absorbers. Here also nowadays so many technologies are available. There are in the viscous fluid we can some of the nowadays silicone oil are going to also peel. It depends in which amount of damper we need. So at that time we can use the amount of which material. Okay, so next one is earthquake early warning system. So it is nothing but there are a number of technologies are given, but as frankly say, not a single researcher can define 100% that whether earthquake will come or not. Okay, so early warning systems is hardly successful. At least 50% we can see the success ratio. So maybe by that in some of the countries like Mexico, Japan, they are continuously using that kind of technologies, because in Japan we can see the in every day or next after the one day earthquakes or tsunamis are already they are coming. So they, some of the technologies we are used in one of the technology, if I talk about the, in earthquake early warning system, so they can they make some kind of that sensors at the very at the depth of particular amount of depth of the that soil, they are just putting that sensors. So where the tectonic plates are crossing with each other, so at that time, at that particular place, they are going to put the sensors. So when the minimum very rare amount of what we can say initial vibrations will occur, so sensors will alarm, give the some kind of alarms, and government is in Japan particularly, that government are going to warn their peoples by that nowadays they are going to make some text message also, they are going to put that that particular amount of time there are the chances for the earthquake or tsunami. So this kind of technologies are also in the demand in the research field. So here what are the basic advantages of that systems are, one is the rapid detections of the earthquake in real time, assessment of that second hazards, so and the notifications of the peoples for the prior shaking, so that we can do. So apart from all that, the ductile kind of materials we can use, obviously it is not that much advanced technology, because we have so many researches are already done, but even though it is also in the demand, because ductility, that it is the major factor that we can apply in our that criteria we can apply in our normal buildings, okay, with the help of minor corrections. So ductility, we know that it is the property of the material, it is unable to undergo the large deformation so before the breaking. So it is nowadays compulsory actually to apply the ductility criteria for our design consideration. So generally the steel is the most common use for the reinforce in the masonry and concrete structures. So it can take both compression as well as tension, and also ductile material, which means the it can also undergo into the large deformation. So now what is the need of the ductile material? So failure of the members should be such that the steel research reaches at the strength before the concrete fails in the compression. It is called the ductile failure. So there is the extra steel in the concrete, obviously it is harmful, because it leads to the brittle of the failure of the concrete, which may generally ductile material we are using for the to make our building earthquake resistant. Okay, so earthquake resistant design using the ductile material, for that various codes are available, so many things are already happened. But even though for the undergraduate students, let me discuss briefly. In a short one or two PPTs, let me discuss the ductility criteria first. So building should be designed for the ductile chain. So considering the multi-story buildings, the reinforced concrete, it consists of horizontal and vertical members, namely beam and column. Okay. So seismic inertia force generated at the floor level are the transferred through the beam and column. So we have to focus on that two components for our normal buildings. One is beam and one is column. So the correct building components that needs to be made a ductile. And the failure of column can be affect the stability of whole buildings, as we know. But the failure of beam cause the localized effect. So therefore, better to make beam as a ductile weak link than the column. So that is that that method designing the RC building with the strong column and weak beam design for the our method. Okay. So many times we have already seen that picture. So because it is very important, so that's why generally we are going to make such arrangement that we have to make a strong column and weak beam. So whenever earthquake will come, so my beam will fail first, and after that column will fail. So we can protect our buildings, or at least we have some amount of time to escape at the hazardous kind of loads or hazardous kind of situations. So in that, let me discuss in later on, but in with the help of that ductility, nowadays that performance based analysis is also come from the same concept. So for that also we have to study the fragility, fragile study also we have to do. So first, whatever the how my building will perform, so let it be perform, and based on that, at which particular point we have to that hinge is going to generate. Hinge is nothing but the severity index, that how much amount of severity will occur at that particular point. So at that time, based on that, we have to design our buildings. So this is a quite interesting research topic for the current scenario. It is performance based analysis. So in ductility, there are so many type of ductilities are there: material ductility, cross section ductility, member ductility, structural ductility, and energy ductility. So I'm not going into the that much of the details of that, but one of the researcher has already done that kind of study for the member ductility, just to ensure the member it is under the reinforced is not enough or not. So therefore they have taken some. These are the properties that they have taken for the specimen, and I am just showing to how to analyze the that kind of beams or anything for the ductility criteria. So these are the mixed design they have done, and stress versus strain means just in previous slides I have shown you the experimental setups. So when we are going to apply the different kind of loadings, so at what amount of strain we are going to apply, on what by making the change in the proportions, we can take a particular what percentage of that property we are getting the maximum strength. Okay. So these are the different curves for the load versus for the moment curvatures and the different steel ratios here or here. So they have in proportions in a property in this figure we can see the steel ratio they have changed. So at what particular amount of steel ratio my structure is my element is having the maximum strength. So that we are going to consider in our design criteria. Okay. Then the second one is structural ductility. I think nowadays in it is the ductility criteria are in the codal provisions are in also. So because it is compulsory to make whole structure at the particularly, at least we have to give some of the escape time, as we discussed, when the severity of earthquakes are very high. So first step is to escape from that particular building. So we have to design in that criteria, we have to think about that criteria. So structural ductility, then energy ductility is also there. So how much amount of energy it is going to dissipate. So for that, as I discussed, that safe memory alloy or that kind of ductile materials or which are having a very high property of energy consumption or energy dissipation. So it dissipate the energy at the time of earthquake or seismic load is going to apply. So we can use that kind of material for the making the energy ductility strong. Then progressive collapse analysis, this is one of the study in which we can by using that criteria we can find how much amount of ductility is we can apply. Because it is also problematic when we are going to apply less ductility or higher ductility. If we apply less ductility at that time, progressive collapse will be occur. Connections will be, connections are going to fail. Then damage in the some of the part at the time of earthquake if less ductility is provided. some of the figures we can see without the ductility criteria, without considering the ductility criteria. Here, failure of joint. So columns are strong enough, beams are also strong enough, but the in between intermediate joints are weak. So at that time, failure will occur. Damage during earthquake, when ductility criteria in here, our main ductility criteria is strong column and weak beam. But here we can see when earthquake occur, so column fail first. So we have to think about that. We don't need to design beam such high enough, more than the column, because when beams are strong enough, so first obviously column will fail, and once column will fail, the whole building will going to collapse within a few seconds. Okay. So now these are about the ductility criteria. We have seen several technologies. One is the dune moss damper, then Safmabry alloys, then retro fittings, as well as the ductile detailing criteria. But when all the technologies, particularly for the ductile detailings, which are very common nowadays, for that we have to make the stronger columns or any stronger elements of the buildings. So at that time, what will happen? The maximum economy will be. Or if we talk about the economical criteria, so it is going to having a more cost will be more. So to make it less amount or make it economical structures, so one of the very reliable kind of technology, it is the seismic isolation. Okay, so let's we talk about the seismic isolation. Now, first of all, the base isolation. So it is the very well established seismic control application. Okay, so at the during the earthquake, the base isolation is able to filter out the, all the high frequencies of the ground motion at the time of earthquake, and it prevents the structures from being damaged or collapsed, and also protect the occupants and in-house sensitive instruments. Generally, what they are doing, they are just shifting the periods of the structure to avoid that, to match that fundamental our fundamental structure period with respect to the earthquake period. So to make to avoid the resonance conditions, here we can see with and without isolation. So just we are by shifting the our time period, we can have the more amount of advantage we can take, or we can avoid the resonance conditions. Now the seismic protection systems are number of seismic protection systems are there. One is seismic isolations, which are considering the elastomeric rubber bearings, lead rubber bearings, sliding isolators, then elastoplastic isolators are there. Then these are also coming into the passive damping kind of systems. It also include the friction kind of isolators, then viscoelastic and viscous kind of dampers. Then semi-active or active kind of systems are various stiffeners, then damping, then bracing system that we have just discussed in our previous slides. Then smart materials are that Safmabry alloys, MR dampers, ER fluids are there. And nowadays they are making the hybrid kind of systems are also there. So base isolations, if we talk about that, that there are number of types of base isolations are there. In India nowadays, natural rubber bearings and high damp rubber bearings are nowadays it is very common in our bridge. So natural rubber bearings, it are there are nothing but the one by one they are making the layers of the rubbers as well as steel plates, and steel plates they are good enough to bear the load of vertical strength, vertical load, and that to give the horizontal flexibility. The rubber layers are given. So these are the typical figures of the rubber bearings. Then additionally, if we add the lead rubbers at the center, lead plug, sorry. So lead plug, if we are going to apply additionally, so with the same amount of advantage, it is going to apply additional energy dissipation. In hysteretic loop also, you can see load versus displacement curve is there. So more area, it means it and consumes the, it dissipate the more energy. So with giving the lead plug, it is going to give the more amount of dissipation in the energy. Okay. So it is with the help of lead plug, we can have a such adjustment that we can use a higher amount of dissipations. Then the next one, nowadays it is in a research field, it is very basic or vulnerable kind of isolator. It is the friction kind of pendulum systems. So this is the single kind of friction pendulum system. Here, what will happen? My whole structure is situated above the that housing plate. One plate is at the above top, and foundation is at above the that one of the slider surface. And in between, articulated sliders are given. So when earthquake will come, my whole structure is going to slide at the right or left side, depending on the directions, and again it will come into the original position. Here we can see the bilinear kind of hysteretic loop is there. So when I apply the load, earthquake load, so gradually the whole building is going to shift over there, and again it will come into the original position. So what will happen? Maximum kind of earthquake, it is going to absorb by the isolator only. So in the upper stories and in structures, there will be a very nominal kind of effect, even in a higher amount of intensity of the structure earthquake, and we can prevent our structure easily. With the same concept of the single kind of isolator, that multiple friction stage isolator systems are come into that with same concept. It is the multi friction pendulum system. It is nothing but to reduce just heat with the obviously there will be a some amount of friction. So if continuous earthquake is going to come, so heat will be generated. So there are another advanced kind of isolators are there. One is double concave friction pendulum systems, and third, second one is triple concave pendulum systems. So here what will happen, here in between articulated slider will be there, and both the plates are act simultaneously. And depend on the severity of earthquake, in the triple friction pendulum system, total four number of plates are given. So at that time what will happen, when earthquake, minor earthquake will come, so above upper plates are also coming to the picture. If severity of earthquake is going to increase, so at that time that lower level of sliders are also coming to the picture. These are the real field pictures of the isolators, and you can imagine this size of that isolators. So here one steel structure is there, and in between the foundation and column or superstructure, isolators are going to applied. So now one is one of the prestigious project in India. It is monitoring by the our IIT Delhi and CPWD. It was the Retroflex showcase building. It is located in Noida, UP, Uttar Pradesh, and it is almost completed. It is the, we can see the first building in our India with the help of the isolator. Okay, it is double isolator. Double friction isolator is there. So we can check in between the foundation and superstructure, that kind of arrangement is given. Obviously, sometimes after the first floor also, this kind of arrangement are going to apply. We can apply. Now, a contiguous friction pendulum system. So it is recent a developed system. It is contiguous friction pendulum system, which is having the six number of sliding surfaces, and it is very having the most complex kind of behavior, and it is advanced in the performance objectives if we are considered. And during very strong seismic events also, it is the demand of that particular seismic absorbers, it is going to fulfill. So here the typical cross section is there. We can see the six number of plates are going here. Okay. So So in between one rigid slider, or you can say articulate sliders are there. So here upper plates are there, depend on the severity of earthquake, number of earthquake slides are going into the coming into the picture. Same concept is there, but it is very complex kind of behavior will be there when we are going to apply the load. And here total 9 number of stages are there. Here stages are nothing but the severity of earthquake. 9 number of earthquake severities will come. So based on the severity, we can see the operational shape of that. If a very high earthquake will come, all the slides are coming into the picture. If very minor earthquakes are there, so hardly that inner plates are going to apply the action. Okay. So when the full operational system is there, so of the contiguous system, at that time it is the cross section view. We can imagine the isolators say for the very higher kind of buildings or any structures are there. So at that time, this is the shape of the building. Okay. So just show me the one or two slides of that, how to model it as in a research field. Generally, now we have seen this kind of isolators are there, but how to model it in our mathematical form. So in any kind of, when we are going to apply the mathematical model, so at that time what will happen, we have to in base isolator, it is the series of the number of different isolators we are going to apply. And in series model, one linear elastic springs are there. In friction element, it represents by the surface friction, and gap elements are also there. So this kind of mathematical some of the mathematical formulations are there. So I am not going into the detail. So these are the again come into the field of the structural dynamics. So let me just show you very quickly. So this kind of equilibrium force systems of the base as well as mass, which represent for the each and every slides we can do. These are some of the mathematical formulation with respect to that non-linear analysis. Okay. So for the analysis of whatever the systems are that I have explained, same kind of analysis is there. One is the non-linear force deformation analysis. So that we can do by our Newmark step-by-step method. So it is very well known, and I think in BTEC also you are going to study in mathematics as well as in some of the subjects also, Newmark step-by-step method. And here also we have used it, fourth order of the Runge-Kutta method. So these are, let me show you just one step. Okay, so, number of earthquakes for the nonlinear analysis, number of earthquakes we can use, and number of properties we can change, and simultaneously we can do the analysis. So let me, as we don't have much enough time. These are the nonlinear hysteretic loops for the linear as well as nonlinear viscoelastic models. So anyway, so let me conclude my presentation. So whenever we are going to in a research field, whenever we are going to apply any kind of new inventions, so at that time we have to think about, first of all, the strength. Obviously, as a researcher, one is our strength, and also our economy is our second governing criteria. And as nowadays the trend is multi-story buildings and any bridges are there. So at that time, apart from that, making this using the strong materials, instead of that, we can use the smart materials or smart technologies. Okay? So that we can take the maximum advantage of that particular our nowadays research trend. Okay. Anyway, so thank you. And if you have any queries or if you have any questions, then you can please ask.
Hello, Ankit sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for such a nice, wonderful session in the field of structural engineering. Actually, due to short of time, many important things we didn't see. But yes, we request you to please share that content so our participants can get benefited from that. And sir, if you don't mind, we will share your detail with our participants. So many persons from industry, sir, so they can get connected with you and they can get advantage from your knowledge, sir, if you don't mind.
Yes, sure, ma'am, sir.
Yes, sir, there is a one question from Darshan Dave, sir. How aerodynamic effect work on skyscraper?
Sorry, can you please repeat?
Sir, Darshan Dave, sir, from one industry asked, how aerodynamic effect work on skyscraper?
Okay, it is obviously it is one of the study in which aerodynamic, if we talk about, so we have shape is the governing factor. Okay, so if we have to make such a shape in the as we see the tune mass damper also we can apply for to minimize our aerodynamic effect, but with the with help of that kind of latest research technology, the shape is the governing factor. So we have to use such a way that depend on the directions and intensity of the air, we have to make shape in such a way that. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Actually, sir, I think there only one question in chat box. So now, means we really, sir, enjoyed your session and also learn a lot from your session. And on behalf of all the participants, as well from our civil department, from our S.N. Patel Institute, we are really very thankful to you that in a very short period, you accepted our invitation and spent that much time for our participants and for us. And in future, sir, also we are seeking such type of support from your end. So thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for such a nice session. And now we will close the session. So I just want to announce to all the participants, there is a small change in tomorrow presentation. By tomorrow, first session will be taken by Ankit Patel, sir, from Ganpat University. And the last session will be taken by me because many participants requested. So based on that, first session will be engaged by Ankit Patel, sir, Ganpat University. Same thing we will convey in WhatsApp group also. So kindly please, as per the revised schedule in WhatsApp group, by tomorrow, please join on time. We will appreciate your online and on-time joining in all the session. Please stay connected, stay safe, take care. So here we are announcing today's first day, close over here. Please, Nikun sir, now you can proceed if you are available. Nikun sir. I think maybe Nikun sir is busy in some work. So now all the participants can leave the session. We will meet by tomorrow.